graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Space Team Universe 10, Sting of the Mustard Mines by Barry J. Hutchison. Narrated by Phil Thron and performed by a full cast.
Cal Carver soft shuffled sideways along the main corridor of the currently untitled, really getting into the groove. Behind him, a gelatinous green blob provided some truly exceptional backup dancing, bending and twisting in time to the beat. Cal bent low, clapped his hands together twice, then danced back a step. Behind him, Splurt mimicked the back step, synchronizing perfectly with Cal so they both seemed to be moving in unison. Halfway along the corridor, Cal kicked against the wall, sprang off, and clicked his heels together in midair. Splurt slid under him, body popped up in front, then flipped backward over Cal's head without missing a beat.
Most impressive, sirs.
Cal spun a full 360, fired both finger guns up in the direction the voice had come from, then went back to dancing his way toward the bridge. He reached out an arm, and Splurt instinctively grew one to match. They linked up, spun around each other in the corridor, then fell back into step as they jigged, skipped, and soft shoe shuffled the final few feet. The bridge door slid open at their approach, revealing the rest of the crew. Cal's happiness level ramped up a notch when he saw them gathered there, all engrossed in their usual shiz. Over there was Lauren, sitting in the pilot's seat, gazing ahead at the stars that came streaking past the ship. As they whizzed by, the stars created a shimmering disco light show across the walls, which only made Cal and Splurt's dancing become even more elaborate. Up at the front stood Mech, his broad metal shoulders reflecting the starlight like a mirror ball. He turned and looked back over his shoulder as Cal entered, his face remaining utterly impassive when Cal's Saturday night fevered his way across the bridge toward him. Miz was in her usual chair, fully alive and utterly disinterested in everything around her. He paused in front of her, tumbling his arms to the beat and thrusting his hips from side to side. He danced that way for a full 15 seconds before she flicked her eyes up from where she was studying her fingernails, tutted once, then looked down again. He spun to find Lauren looking him up and down.
What are you wearing?
It's a lemon yellow jumpsuit with killer flares and a collar to funking die for. Why do you ask?
That ain't lemon yellow. That's mustard.
No funking way is this mustard.
Cal held his arms wide, then jabbed a thumb over his left shoulder, then his right, hitchhiking his way toward the cyborg in time to the beat. Behind him, Splurt mimicked the move, but timed it so they were always moving in opposite directions.
Please don't do that. And it is mustard.
He scowled at himself.
I don't even care. Why am I having this funkin' conversation?
Oh, come on, Mech. Don't be like that. Dance with me, big guy.
Mech shook his head, but then, to the surprise of everyone on the bridge, began dancing mechanically in time to the music.
Hey! You're doing the robot!
It ain't the funkin' robot.
Mech shrugged.
I mean, yeah. I guess it is.
He kicked out a leg and spun, demonstrating a sense of rhythm that was positively Michael Jackson-esque.
Man, this song is infectious.
Come on, everyone else on their feet.
Cal pulled Lauren out of her seat and wrapped an arm around her waist. She struggled for a moment, but then rolled her eyes and fell into step with him.
Next right. It's mustard.
Cal looked back over his shoulder.
Miz, what about you? You dancing?
Miz flicked her eyes up to him and Lauren, then glanced between Splurt and Mech.
I'll pass.
Fair enough.
Cal raised an arm and spun Lauren beneath it.
Toby Maguire, how about you, buddy?
Former Hollywood actor Toby Maguire turned in his chair. For some reason, he was dressed like Uhura from Star Trek, complete with an oversized earpiece and tight-fitting red dress. Toby Maguire didn't need to be asked twice. He bounded to his feet and began to gyrate in a way that was not completely out of time with the music, but bordering on sexual assault.
Selby McGuire, I hope you never change.
A thought hit him.
Wait, Toby McGuire? What are you doing here?
Cal!
Lauren was out of Cal's arms and back in the pilot's seat now, a strained expression on her face.
It's no use. I think he's dead, ma'am.
We should be so fucking lucky.
Cal blinked and looked around. The cyborg was standing by the screen again, gripping the control panel in front of him. Toby McGuire was sitting back at his station, too, hailing on all frequencies but presumably getting no response. As Cal watched, he faded from view, becoming merely a ghost of Toby McGuire before vanishing completely.
Huh? No, I'm not dead. I don't think I'm dead.
Miz was suddenly right in front of him, towering above. Her fur smelled damp, like a dog who'd been out too long in the rain.
I know how to wake him up.
Something mischievous flashed in her deep brown eyes, and Cal felt a sudden sharp pressure somewhere he'd much rather he didn't. Cal jumped, his eyes wide, his mouth open, and every other part of his body feeling utterly violated. Miz was kneeling over him, a grin twisting her muzzle.
Jesus! Did you just stick a claw up my ass?
Totally. They told me to wake you, and that always works.
Well, I wish you'd have... Wait, what do you mean, always? And how the funk could you jam a claw up my ass when I'm wearing pants?
You don't want to know.
And hold the funking phone! We can say ass now? Since when could we... Hey, is it me, or is something on fire?
Everything's on fire, sir.
Cal jumped to his feet and whipped around in panic. A wispy cloud of black smoke surrounded his chair. Further searches of the bridge revealed no evidence of anything else being ablaze.
Well, no. Everything was an exaggeration. But your chair is definitely smoldering.
How the funk is my chair on fire? I mean, it's a chair. Chairs just don't spontaneously... Hey, who the funk are those guys?
Cal gestured to where several dozen small ships were engaged in battle with three much larger ones.
No!
Something slammed into the side of the Untitled, sending Cal staggering across the bridge.
They're the people Lauren keeps letting shoot us. I'm not letting them shoot us.
Well, you sure as funk ain't not letting them shoot us.
A gloopy green tendril wrapped around his waist, hoisted him aloft, then deposited him in one of the seats fastened to the bridge's rear bulkhead wall.
The guest chairs, Splurt? Seriously, you're putting me in the funking guest chairs?
Cal shook his head.
This is a new low. I don't care if it's smoking. I'll risk sitting in my actual chair.
Cal's actual chair went up in flames. He watched it crackle and spit for several seconds before a single sprinkler activated above it, and a spray of white foam doused the flames.
Okay, on second thought, I'll stay here.
He searched around beneath himself and found one end of the seatbelt.
By the way, I don't know if anyone else has noticed this, but someone is funking shooting at us!
Miz, who is now slouched back in her own chair, hooked a leg over her armrest and rolled her eyes.
Yeah, we know. We had like a whole conversation about it 5 seconds ago.
We did? Sorry, I was sort of staggering wildly across the bridge and trying not to die.
Are you strapped in?
Cal hunted for the other half of the seatbelt.
No, I can't find part of the belt.
Well, hurry up.
Up ahead, a bright red torpedo was tumbling through space toward them.
Aw, shiz.
Cal's search became more frantic.
What is wrong with this belt? Where's the other half?
Cal, hurry!
What other half?
Cal held up half of the lap belt and gave it a waggle.
I have this half. I need the other half.
Mech glowered at him.
The funking... the other half. You know, it looks exactly like this half, but it's pointing the other way, like the opposite of this. The other funking half. I can't find it.
Incoming torpedo, ma'am.
I see it.
Very good. Just thought I'd check, since you don't appear to be attempting any sort of evasive action of any description.
Lauren looked back over her shoulder.
Cal, strap in!
I need the other half!
There ain't no other fucking half!
Cal blinked. He looked down at the belt in his hand.
So what, it's broken? Jesus, now you tell me.
Splurt's tentacle reached over, took the belt, unfolded it so it doubled in length, then clipped it into the housing.
Oh, that's how it works. Well, some instructions would have gone...
The rest of the sentence backflipped down his throat as the currently untitled plunged into a dive, spun in several tight concentric loops, then banked up and to the right. Cal was flung violently in the seat, the lap belt nowhere near as effective a restraint as the chest straps of his usual station.
Fucking guest chairs.
Lauren spiraled out of the way of an oncoming fighter, climbed steeply, then flew directly into the path of the torpedo she dodged just a moment ago. The untitled shuddered from nose to tail. The bridge lights flickered.
Like, isn't the whole point to not get hit by the missiles?
Torpedoes, ma'am. And technically, it didn't hit us. We hit it.
And that's better?
Oh my, no. Worse, if anything. Quite impressive, though. She literally had an infinite amount of space to fly in where that torpedo currently wasn't. And yet she somehow found the one place in all the universe where it was. The odds are quite staggering.
Well, yay, Lauren!
Oh, shut up.
Lauren threw the ship into a spin that Cal was sure was completely unnecessary and probably done out of spite.
Mech, any intel on who these guys are?
Nothing yet. The ship's designs don't match up with anything in the databanks. Their ident signals aren't recognized either. I got no idea who they are.
The big ones or the little ones?
Both. We got nothing on any of those ships.
Which ones are shooting at us?
Both.
Son of a... How is that fair? Do they know we saved the universe?
I doubt it.
Well, then let's tell them. Call them up. Get them on Space Skype and tell them who we are. I'm sure once they know who they're dealing with, they'll think twice about...
Look out.
Thanks for the heads up, Kevin.
Oh, you're welcome, ma'am. I was worried it came a little late to be of much use, so it's good to know... Wait. Were you being sarcastic?
Another impact rattled the Untitled, spraying static across the screen and making one of the armrests fall off Cal's chair.
Oh, not Righty! Righty was my favorite!
Look out!
Get them on space phone right now!
Cal sat up straighter and smoothed down the front of his Dorothy on the Streets, Blanche in the Sheets t-shirt.
Kevin, camera on me, but, you know, high angle, kind of imposing, but mysterious.
And it hides your double chin.
That's a side benefit, Mac. Side benefit. And I don't have a double chin. At most, it's a chin and a half.
How's this, sir?
The flickering on screen cleared momentarily to reveal an image of Cal.
That's the top of my head. Not that high an angle. Down. Down. A little down.
On screen, Cal's face came into view.
There. Right there. Can we do mood lighting? I'm thinking like noble yet sinister. Can we do that?
I can probably do on, lighting-wise, sir. That's the best I can do.
Funk. Okay, that'll have to do. Get someone on the line and I'll give them a piece of my... Jesus Christ, what the funk is that thing?
A face had appeared on screen. Or a close approximation of one, at least. It was mostly nostrils and teeth, with a few scraps of chalk-white flesh assembled like a frame around them. There were no obvious eyes that Cal could see, but while he was staring in mute horror at the creature, something blinked deep in the hollows of the nostrils.
Okay, that's unpleasant.
Cal looked to the others for help.
I think my chip is fritzed.
Not just yours. I ain't getting any translation.
Kevin, what language is that?
I'm afraid I have no idea, ma'am. I'd run a full linguistic analysis, but I'm rather busy at the moment.
Busy with what?
It's funny you should ask, ma'am. I'm trying to restore power to the flight systems.
The flight systems don't have power?
Lauren pushed and pulled on a couple of levers, but the Untitled didn't respond. Two eyes emerged from its nostrils on stalks and splatted against the camera, so they appeared to be smearing themselves across the screen, leaving a slug-like trail of snot wherever they crisscrossed over the glass.
Well, that seems unnecessary.
Cal drew a hand across his throat and glared up at the ceiling.
Kevin, cut feed and call. Hang up.
Again, sir, rather busy at the moment. Perhaps on this occasion, Master Mech might be so good as to press the button? If it's not too much trouble, I've just discovered another problem I'm in the process of trying to resolve.
Great. What's the other problem?
Mac pressed the button that cut the comm link between the Untitled and the alien ship. What had been a screen full of teeth and nostrils became a screen full of rough, barren terrain that spiraled wildly as it rushed toward them.
That is, in all the excitement, I rather failed to notice that we entered planetary atmosphere. I estimate impact in less than 5 minutes.
We're crashing?
Like, how can that even come as a surprise at this point?
Motherfucker!
If Cal were forced to describe the impact, he wouldn't use words. He wouldn't be able to find them. Instead, he'd make a sort of sporksh noise, followed by several badungs and one big karunk at the end that rattled his bones, smashed his head against the bulkhead wall, and caused some light soiling in the underwear department. Fortunately, on this occasion, only the front.
Impact in quite a lot less than 5 minutes. Brace.
Cal waved a hand in front of his face in an attempt to bat away a cloud of smoke. The arm flopped limply. The bones in his forearm snapped cleanly in two.
Oh, that's not good.
Everyone okay?
Mostly.
A searing pain made him look down.
Wait, no. Oh, Funk. One of my legs is back to front.
He shook his head.
Funking guest chairs.
Still in one piece here.
Miz?
Fine. No thanks to you.
Splurt wobbled in Cal's lap. Cal patted his blobby body with the hand that wasn't currently hanging off.
I got you, buddy. Nothing to worry about.
He gestured down to his twisted leg.
I hate to ask, but could you do the honors?
Two vine-like arms grew from Splurt's body and wrapped around Cal's leg. Cal jammed his fist into his mouth and nodded.
Go!
When the foot was facing front again, Splurt rocked back in Cal's lap, looking pleased with himself.
Oh, great way there, right? But I'm pretty sure you turned it the wrong way.
Splurt's bulbous eyes flicked down to Cal's leg. He wobbled apologetically, then twisted the leg a full 360 until the foot was pointing forward again.
Thanks. You nailed it that time.
The view screen was in darkness. The rest of the bridge would have been, too, had Cal's chair not spontaneously burst into flames again.
Seriously, what the funk is wrong with that thing?
Lauren grimaced as she unclipped herself from her own, now lopsided chair and fell onto the floor.
Where are we?
I've run some calculations, ma'am, and have concluded that we are on the ground.
We already worked that part out. Which funkin' ground? What planet are we on?
That's trickier to say, sir. According to the star map, we're in a sort of no-man's land territory where the planets haven't been given agreed-upon galaxy-recognized names. This one still goes by the original local designation, which roughly translates as destitution.
Right. I mean, of course it does. Where the funk else would we crash land?
Gritting his teeth, he squished the bones in his arm back into place and held them there until his rapid healing abilities kicked in, knitting the break back together.
Just once, I'd love us to crash on, like, Planet Nice or something.
Oh, Planet Nice. Yes, I've been there.
Seriously? There's a Planet Nice? What's it like?
Thoroughly awful, sir.
Great. Well, that's disappointing.
Lauren grabbed the edges of her console and pulled herself upright. She toggled a few switches, but nothing was responsive.
What's it like out there?
It's called destitution. I'm gonna go out on a limb and say, not great.
Atmosphere?
Not particularly, ma'am. It's all rather sedate and downbeat. Very little buzz about the place at all.
I mean, is it breathable?
Oh, yes, I see. Quite breathable. The temperature's a little higher than some of you might feel entirely comfortable with, but tolerable. There is limited flora and fauna, various scattered life signs, and what appears to be a small settlement a few miles in that direction.
Nobody bothered to remind Kevin that they couldn't see which direction he was pointing.
Also, we're sinking.
There was a lengthy pause as everyone took this information in, particularly that last part.
What the funk do you mean we're sinking?
I'm afraid I don't really know another way of putting it, sir. We, the collective us, I mean, are sinking.
Cal fiddled with his belt until it finally released him. He stood up.
Sinking? In what way?
Well, the down way, sir. I'd have thought that was rather a given.
I didn't see any water.
Well, you didn't see the planet, so...
We're not sinking in water, ma'am. It appears to be a form of quicksand.
Quicksand? All right, yes. I am so prepared for this.
You are?
Oh, God, yes. I grew up in the 80s. Quicksand was funking everywhere on TV in the 80s. People were falling in the stuff on a daily basis. The A-Team, Magnum P.I., Michael Knight on Knight Rider, all just falling into it, left, right, and center. Seriously, it was like quicksand Armageddon. And I picked up a trick or two. See, it's actually very easy to get out of it, if you know how.
Any advice you could offer would be much appreciated, sir.
Cal rocked back on his heels and tucked his thumbs into an imaginary pair of suspenders.
It's simple. We all just have to stay perfectly still.
Everyone stayed perfectly still.
We're still sinking, sir.
Shiz. Are we? Then I got nothing.
Can we open the hatch?
Not if you want to live, ma'am. The airlock is a possibility, though. But you'll have to be quick.
How quick?
You have about 9 seconds. So, I suggest you all... Oh, they're gone. Bye then.
Cal was first out of the airlock after Mech pulled it open. The Untitled was listing badly, and getting through the airlock involved a lot of awkward clambering and an assisting hand from Splurt.
Yeah.
As he emerged, Cal squinted in the glare of the planet's twin suns. His hand practically sizzled on the metal as he heaved himself onto the side of the ship and surveyed their surroundings. The Untitled had ditched in a pool of gloopy, mud-like sand that extended as far as the horizon, with no obvious solid ground in sight.
Oh, funk.
Lauren and Miz emerged through the airlock door behind him.
We're screwed. There's nowhere to go.
What about there?
Lauren pointed in the opposite direction. Cal turned all the way around and found a solid shoreline just 10 or so feet away.
Oh, yeah, I mean, yeah, we could go that way. Sure, why not?
He shot both women a grin.
Race you!
Cal jumped feet first into the quicksand. Anyone looking closely may have seen the exact moment his face registered the realization that this, on balance, was probably a mistake. But then he was gone, his momentum driving him deep into the gloopy, mud-like morass.
Totally saw that coming.
Cal!
Lauren dropped to her knees and peered over the edge. Mech heaved himself onto the side of the ship and looked around.
Where the fuck did he go?
Miz pointed over the edge with a clawed finger. Mech's metal jaw dropped.
You gotta be kidding me.
There was a blur of movement from the airlock as something green and arrow-shaped rocketed out of the Untitled, changed direction in midair, then burrowed into the gloop. With a twitch of her legs, Miz propelled herself onto the shore, throwing up a cloud of dusty sand when she landed. Lauren hooked herself onto Mech's arm and held tight as he fired up his foot rockets and launched them off the side of the sinking ship. Once on solid ground, they all turned back to the currently Untitled. Two of its rear wings stuck straight up from the quicksand. Kevin snapped the door closed.
Kevin, you okay?
Peachy, ma'am. Couldn't be better. Why do you ask?
Well...
Wait, no. I'm not great, actually. Perhaps I might trouble you for a favor. I wonder if you'd be so good as to...
The quicksand suction drew the ship further into its soggy depths. Then the few parts of the ship that had been above ground sunk out of sight. For a few moments, there was nothing but silence.
Well, way to go, Lauren.
This wasn't my fault.
Well, you were flying.
Cal rolled up out of the depths, flipped all the way over, then flopped onto his back. He lay there, encased from head to toe in sandy sludge.
Did I win?
He sat up when a perfect sphere of sand emerged from the gloop and bounced toward him.
Jesus, Splurt, you almost gave me a heart attack.
Splurt shook like a dog, throwing quicksand in all directions. It splattered across Mech's chest, plastered Miz's fur, and caked across Lauren's face.
Did you have to?
You know how hard it is to get sand out of fur? Thanks a lot, Splurt.
Splurt wobbled apologetically, then rolled himself into a tall funnel shape, bent backward, and plunged into the quicksand.
Now where's he going? And where's the ship?
It sank.
Like, sank?
Yeah, like sank.
Shiz. Did we say way to go, Lauren, yet?
Totally.
Nah, can't believe I missed that part.
It wasn't my fault.
Well, you were flying.
That's what I said.
And he knows stuff, like space stuff, you know?
He smiled warmly at Lauren and placed his hands on her shoulders.
Look, nobody's actually blaming you, okay? Nobody's pointing fingers, you know, except Ms. Mech and me, okay?
He winked at her, patted her shoulder, then turned around and rubbed his hands together.
Now, I'm guessing Splurt's trying to get the ship back for us, so in the meantime, I suggest we...
Cal stopped. An imposing figure in faded desert fatigues stood before him, glaring at him through a set of cracked goggles.
Stumble upon a large, menacing man.
Cal cupped a hand above his eyes to block out the sun and shot the newcomer one of his most winning smiles.
Hey there! Oh, are we glad to see...
An open-hand strike caught Cal in the center of his chest. The force of it lifted him off his feet and sent him sprawling onto the sand, the air in his lungs now nothing more than a memory. Lauren sprang over the fallen Cal, spinning out her leg to deliver a devastating flying kick. The stranger caught her leg mid-leap, twisted her around and up over his head, then smashed her into the sand. Shrugging it off, Lauren kipped up onto her feet and lunged with a flurry of punches that all failed to find their target. Weaving out of her reach, the man in the fatigues drove a three-finger strike into a nerve cluster above Lauren's armpit, and all her strength seemed to flow out of that side of her body and into the sand, pulling her down with it.
You shouldn't have come here.
Mizette was now stalking toward him, teeth bared, claws extended.
No one humiliates Lauren but us.
He didn't humiliate me.
He totally did. It was embarrassing, but I've got him.
She lunged for the stranger, but found herself slashing at thin air when he vaulted up and over her back. Miz spun to try again, only for several thousand volts of electricity to course through her from a coin-sized metal device he'd placed on the back of her neck.
Oh, you suck.
She flopped onto the ground beside Lauren, most of her fur standing on end.
Now who's humiliated?
It's still you. It's like totally still you.
She began to rise, but another shock face-planted her back into the sand. The stranger threw himself at Mech, only for a metal hand to clamp around his head, stopping him.
I don't know who the funk you are, but you made a big mistake messing with it.
The man caught Mech's wrist with both hands, pulled himself up, then used his feet to kick the dial on Mech's chest. Mech's hydraulic power was fully diverted into his intellect.
Oh, smart move. I'm amazed no one has considered a similar approach before.
His grip on the stranger's head released, and Mech toppled backward onto the ground, completely immobile. Cal pulled himself up as far as his knees and made a T-shape with his hands.
Okay, time out. I'll be honest, this is not the welcome I was hoping for. Obviously, there's been some sort of mistake, and you don't know who we are.
The stranger approached him slowly. Despite the heat, and the fact he'd taken down the entire team, he didn't seem to have broken a sweat. Although that said, it was hard to be sure. His head was partly covered by a length of graying cloth that wrapped around it like a bandage, while the goggles did a good job of hiding most of his face. All Cal could really see was a chiseled jaw that hadn't been shaved in a few days, a downturned scowl of a mouth, and a neck you could probably anchor ships to.
I don't care who you are. I only care who sent you.
Sent us? No one sent us. Why would anyone send us? We crashed.
Bullshiz.
The stranger caught Cal by the front of his t-shirt and hoisted him easily to his feet. If Cal's legs hadn't already been weak, the heady aroma of raw testosterone would probably have taken his feet out from under him.
Who sent you?
God, you're manly.
Cal smirked.
Which means this will really hurt.
He drove a knee into the stranger's groin. Pain exploded in his kneecap.
Ow, funk!
Cal looked down.
Jesus, what are your balls made of? Concrete blocks?
The stranger released his grip on Cal's t-shirt and caught him by the throat instead. He lifted him effortlessly until Cal's feet dangled in midair.
I'm gonna ask you again. Who sent you?
Nobody.
Who sent you?
Okay. I'll tell you everything.
The stranger relaxed his grip enough that Cal was able to speak more clearly.
Tell me.
Fine, you win. Billy Ocean.
The stranger hesitated for a moment.
Who?
It was Billy Ocean. Billy Ocean sent us. I don't know what you did to him, but that guy really funking hates you.
The grip tightened again.
What are you talking about? I don't know who that is.
You don't? Oh, don't tell me you've got the wrong guy again. Are you, Harold Spaceman?
The stranger scowled behind his goggles.
What the hell are you talking about?
Cal felt those fingers constrict further around his throat. Then there was a flurry of movement from the quicksand.
Oh, thank God.
Something that looked like a cross between the Hound of the Baskervilles and the much larger and more aggressive cousin of the Hound of the Baskervilles crashed into the stranger, sending both him and Cal sprawling across the sand. The large dog creature became something not unlike several species of octopus, all trying to exist at the same point in space and time, and all coming off badly. The stranger kicked out. But one of the thing's countless whipping tentacles pinned his limbs to the ground, then dropped the weight of its blobby green body on top of him, completely trapping him in place.
Way to go, buddy. Oh, God.
Cal rubbed his throat.
You really seized the element of surprise there. Good job.
Splurt wobbled.
No, element of surprise.
Splurt wobbled again.
Well, I don't know. What even is an elephant of surprise?
Cal gave a shake of his head.
Forget it. It's element, trust me. Now, keep that shiznod there while I figure out what to do with him.
Cal turned, cricked his back, then shuffled over to the others, who were all still sprawled on the sand.
Salutations, Cal. I appear to have found myself in rather a spot of difficulty. Your assistance would be immeasurably gratifying.
Oh, but you're always so much nicer like this. Okay, fine. I'll switch you back. Hold still.
I do not exactly have a myriad of other choices in that regard. Vis-a-vis staying still, I mean.
Yeah.
Mech's metal frame twitched back into life and he sat up, glaring at the captive stranger.
Oh, man. I am gonna have me some words with that guy.
You're welcome.
Cal crossed to where Lauren and Miz lay side by side.
Miz, honey, don't move, okay? This won't hurt.
He tugged on the metal disc that was stuck to the back of her neck. Electricity surged through them both.
No, my mistake. Ah, that hurt a lot.
Cal sucked on his fingers.
You should try it from my side sometime.
Mech, can you take this thing off? I'll get Lauren.
I'm fine.
Lauren managed to yank her mostly lifeless left arm out from beneath her. Cal hung back, giving her space to do whatever she was going to do next. Nothing much, it seemed.
Fine. Give me a hand, then. Funny. Help me up.
Hooking an arm around her, Cal heaved Lauren up onto her feet. She hopped unsteadily for a moment, tentatively placing her left foot on the ground, then gave Cal a slightly wobbly nod.
You sure?
I'm okay.
Cal released his grip on her, but kept his hands raised, ready to catch her if she fell.
I'm fine.
She opened and closed her mouth a few times, waggled her tongue, then gave a more confident nod.
I'm fine.
Mech crushed the metal disc that had been keeping Miz down. She sprang up with one swift pounce and bounded across the sand on all fours, tail extended, the fur around her collar all standing on end.
Miz, wait!
A tentacle blocked her path, forcing her to skid to a stop. She peered down at the pinned stranger from the other side of the gooey barricade.
You don't scare me, Grakes.
Give me 30 seconds, and I'll totally change that.
Cal and Mech joined Miz, while Lauren limped up behind them. Splurt raised his tentacle barrier, letting Cal pass.
So?
Cal looked the stranger up and down.
Comfy?
The stranger glared back through his goggles.
Who are you?
You know damn well who I am.
No. No, I don't think so, Mech.
Nuh-uh.
Miz, do you know who this guy is?
No.
She extended her claws to their full, terrifying reach.
But, like, I'm going to know him intimately in a minute.
Cal placed the back of his hand next to his mouth.
I think you got on her bad side.
He turned to Lauren just as she limped up, dragging her leg behind her.
Lauren, are you familiar with our friend here?
No.
No.
Cal looked away, then looked back.
You've got some drool on your chin there.
Lauren wiped her chin.
Not that side, the side where your face is all funked.
Lauren's eyebrows raised. Or one of them, at least.
What do you mean my face is funked? How is my face funked?
Mech turned to look.
Oh man, that is nasty.
What's wrong with my face?
Cal raised his hands in a calming gesture.
Nothing. Nothing. It's fine. I shouldn't have said funked. That was the wrong choice of words. I just mean it's kind of...
He placed a hand on his cheek and pulled down one side of his face, making himself look horribly disfigured.
Like that. Like you've had a stroke.
He caught Lauren's horrified expression and tried to head off her concerns.
But, you know, a sexy stroke. Like a hot, sexy... I like it. Is the point I'm trying to make. It's a good look. I hear plastic left too close to a radiator is really in this season.
Lauren patted anxiously at the side of her face.
I'm kidding. It's fine. I'm sure that'll tighten right up in no time.
He turned back to the stranger.
So, I've done a survey, and it turns out that none of us have the faintest funking clue who you are or why you attacked us.
Cal squatted, just beyond the man's maximum possible reach, and offered him one of the most natural-looking of his many well-rehearsed smiles.
So, here's what's going to happen.
We're going to turn all your inside parts into outside parts, then feed them to you.
Cal raised a finger.
Well, not exactly where I was going, but sure, definitely a possibility. We're definitely not ruling that out, just putting it on the back burner for now. Right now, we're going to try a different approach. We're going to wipe the slate clean. We're going to assume all this has been some hilarious misunderstanding that we'll all have a good laugh about later, and we're going to start afresh.
He glanced around at the others, then back to the stranger.
Nobody sent us. We're only here because our pilot didn't notice your enormous planet until we were 1/16th of a mile away from it.
Way to go, Lauren.
Oh, shut up.
So, if you promise not to switch us off or electrocute us or punch us until we have a stroke...
He looked back at Lauren and gave her a reassuring smile.
Sexy stroke. Then I'll tell Splurt to let you go. Okay?
The stranger said nothing.
It's good for you that I'm wearing my trusting pants, and I'm going to take your calculated indifference as a yes.
Cal stood up, and Splurt sproinged back into a ball shape, all his many tentacles retracting back into his rapidly shrinking body. Cal held a hand out to the stranger. For a moment, it looked like he might accept it, but then he rolled backward and was suddenly up on his feet. He didn't raise his fists or adopt any sort of fighting stance, but he had an air about him that suggested he could kick the living shiz out of them all without having to do either.
I'm Cal, Cal Carver. That's Miz, Mech, and Lauren. And this adorable little bamston is Splurt. We're Space Team. You probably heard of us.
The stranger shook his head.
No.
He looked them up and down.
Are you, with the circus?
The circus? Seriously? No, we're not with the circus.
He looked around at the others.
Wait, there's a circus? Why have we never... Forget it.
He directed his attention back to the stranger.
We saved the galaxy, like, what, 5 times? Saved the whole funking universe at least twice. Space Team. Capital S, capital T. You must have heard of us. No?
I tend not to keep up with the news.
Ah, then that explains it. That'll be why. I thought it was weird you not knowing about us. We're kind of a big deal.
Cal raised his eyebrows expectantly.
And you are?
I'm not a big deal.
Well, no, obviously.
Cal gestured at the rugged emptiness around them.
That pretty much goes without saying. I was asking your name.
Oh. what the hell?
He pushed his goggles up onto his head, revealing 2 eyes that seemed to be narrowed in a state of permanent suspicion.
The name's Kanto Gar. And if you folks really did wind up here by accident, then you must be the unluckiest sons of bitches I've ever met.
Yeah, that pretty much sums us up.
Unlucky? Why are we unlucky? I mean, aside from being shot down, crashing, and having our ship sink into the ground.
He turned to Splurt before Kanto could answer.
Did you find it, by the way? Did you see the ship?
Splurt wobbled.
What did he say?
He said...
Lauren closed her eyes for a full 2 seconds.
And what does that translate as?
No, he didn't find the ship.
Great. That's just fucking great.
If it's in the silch, it's gone.
The what?
The silch. The sand that pulled your ship down. We call it the silch.
Right. We would call it that, but I was thinking, hear me out. Space quicksand.
I don't much care what you were thinking. It's silch, and your ship is gone.
What? No, it can't be gone.
That stuff goes deep.
Kanto pulled his goggles back down over his eyes and took a small tin from his pocket. It was bashed and dented, as if it had seen some hard times.
Your ship could be a mile down by now, and still sinking.
Funk, what about Kevin?
Kanto opened his tin, then paused.
You have someone on board the ship?
Yes. No. Kind of. He is the ship. I mean, I think.
Cal turned to Mech.
He is the ship, right?
No.
He's kind of the ship.
He ain't the ship.
Cal made a face that Mech couldn't see, but which suggested that Kanto should ignore him.
He's kind of the ship.
Kanto reached into the tin and took out a clear capsule, no bigger than a grain of rice. He tossed it all the way to the back of his throat, swallowed, then held the tin out to Cal.
Water?
Cal peered into the tin. There were a few hundred of the translucent grains nestled in the bottom.
I hate to tell you, but that's not water. I've seen water. It's a liquid.
It's dehydrated water. Take one or the heat'll kill you.
Cal hesitated. Kanto withdrew the tin.
Or don't. I don't care.
No, I'll take one.
Cal fumbled in the tin until his fingers finally managed to grasp one of the minuscule tiny capsules.
When in Rome, right?
He raised the capsule in a sort of toast, then placed it on his tongue. Half a gallon of water exploded from Cal's mouth, fountained out through his nostrils, and flooded backward down his throat. He bent double, his eyes wet with tears, the rest of him just wet in general.
Jesus, what the funk happened there?
You're supposed to swallow it.
Kanto offered the tin again.
Want to try again?
Funk, no.
Cal waved the tin away.
I'm fine, just took me by surprise is all.
Kanto offered the capsules to the others.
Anyone?
Sure.
Lauren took one. Miz stepped in closer and eyeballed him.
Like I'd accept anything from you.
Despite this, she snatched 3, tossed them all to the back of her throat, and swallowed. That done, she bared her teeth at Kanto, then stepped back to join the others.
What were we talking about?
Your ship being gone?
Kanto snapped the tin shut and returned it to his pocket. He glanced up at the sky. One of the suns was half hidden by the horizon, while the second was headed in the same direction.
But, we have bigger problems right now.
Of course we do. What is it this time?
Not space bears. Tell me it isn't space bears.
Slurrits.
Say what now?
Slurrits.
Yeah, I thought that's what you said, but just repeating it doesn't really clarify it any.
Slurrits live down in the silch. They come out at night to hunt and scavenge.
Hunt and scavenge in, like, a nice way?
Not if you're the hunted or the scavenged.
Kanto gestured to a spot a few hundred yards away that looked much the same as every other patch of empty ground surrounding it.
I've got a camp that way. We should head there.
And leave the ship? We can't leave the ship.
She's right. If we lose the ship, we'll, like, be totally stuck on this shithole of a planet.
You're right. Mech, can you mark this spot so we can track our way back here?
Mark the spot?
Yeah. Have you got an app for that? Like for keeping track of where you parked? You must have some way to mark this place.
Mech looked at the ground around him, shrugged, then he drew an arrow in the sand with his foot.
That good enough?
Well, I was hoping for something a little more high-tech, but funk it. It'll do.
Cal cupped his hands around his mouth.
Kevin! Don't worry, we're coming for you. Eventually. We haven't forgotten you, pal. Hold tight. Be strong, sweet prince. We all love you.
He looked around at the others.
Was that too much?
Maybe a little.
We should go. The Slurrets will be rising soon. We don't want to be here when they do.
Kanto set off past them, headed in the direction he'd pointed.
So, like, we're not actually going with this guy, are we?
It's him or the Slurrets, and I've heard some pretty nasty things about those guys.
From him?
True, yes. He might have kicked our asses and punched Lauren's face loose, but I don't know. I quite like him. He reminds me of someone. Don't know who, but someone awesome. Side note, we can definitely say ass now. How do we think that happened?
We messed around with time. It was never going to go back exactly as it used to be.
I guess so. Still, that's the only thing that's changed. I'd say we got off pretty lightly.
He glanced after Kanto, who hadn't looked back once since he'd set off, then turned to the others.
Now, all those in favor of staying here?
Miz immediately thrust a hand into the air. Mech glanced from Kanto's back to the expanse of Silch. Eventually, he raised his hand, too.
Okay, that's two. All in favor of going with him?
He and Lauren both raised their hands. Splurt grew several dozen baby-sized arms and held them all aloft.
That's, I don't know, let's say a conservative 50. Looks like we won.
How the funk is that fear?
Because it just is.
Cal gestured after Kanto.
So, shall we?
They followed Kanto to a crack in the ground. Then, with varying degrees of difficulty, they navigated along a narrow chasm until they reached an almost perfectly spherical cave with a sleeping bag at one end and something not unlike a gas camping stove sitting in the center. A motorcycle stood near the sleeping bag, propped against the curved stone wall. It was a wide, squat machine with chunky tires that were as tall as the rest of the bike. The frame was an elaborate tangle of matte black metal that wrapped around the furry seat like a protective nest. A tinted glass windshield curved up from the bike's front before almost meeting a steeply sloping rear windshield that sprouted in the opposite direction.
Cool bike! Can I touch it?
No, you can't.
Cal waited until Kanto had looked away, then touched the bike anyway.
Ow!
Oh, like, thanks a lot.
That wasn't my fault. It just went off when I was near it.
Stop.
I've stopped. See? I'm not doing...
Cal lowered his hands.
Oh, you were talking to the bike. Gotcha.
Don't touch it again.
Gotcha. Message received.
Cal made a show of tiptoeing backward away from the bike. Miz unfolded her ears again, while Cal took in the rest of their surroundings.
Nice place you've got here. A little cavey, maybe, but nothing a carpet, a lick of paint, four walls, and a roof wouldn't fix.
It sucks.
Kanto shrugged and sat on the ground near the stove.
It'll keep you alive for the night. Between the Slurrets and the Growlers, you really don't want to be out there.
Growlers.
The others looked at him.
What about them?
It's just, where I come from, it can mean something else.
Lauren raised an eyebrow in interest.
What can it mean?
It's like, you know, it means...
He pointed surreptitiously to his crotch. All eyes followed his finger.
It means... penis?
What? No.
You're pointing to your penis.
You can't fault the man's power of observation.
Not penis, vagina.
Kanto pushed his goggles up onto his head.
You have a vagina?
What? No, that's not... I don't have... I'm just saying, and I'm kind of starting to wish I hadn't opened my mouth, I'm just saying that growler is a word some people on Earth use instead of, you know, Lady Garden.
He saw how everyone was looking at him, Lauren in particular.
Bad people, I mean, nasty, horrible people who really should know better than to disrespect women's vaginas.
Right. Well, these growlers are not vaginas. They're sort of hairy, smelly.
Cal opened his mouth, considering all the possible reactions to what he was about to say.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.